when you learn how to play with a variety of casts on. It's my favorite break was when I broke my foot because it didn't really affect much. But I did just sprain my thumb, my left thumb. So my thumb position was really clanky. It was amazing. All right. Let's see. So have you ever considered just using a strap?
Yeah, I have a strap at home. I should have
probably. Okay. I tell you, once I went with a strap, my life was like so much easier because I just never had to worry anymore. Wow, you play great. Your left hand has so much expression, and your intonation is really good. If I were to ask you how you produce your vibrato,
probably with my wrist.
With wrist?
Yeah.
So what is vibrato?
Like slight changes in the frequency. Like.
Yeah. Actually, basically, yeah. It's a manipulation of pitch, right? So, let's see, so we have kind of a similar issue in our fingertips, which is we have very thin fingertips, which sometimes makes it tough to get a wide enough vibrato, right? It's easier for us on the C string for some reason, that it's easier to do, like play your first E. Good. Would you try not to stack too many fingers? Good. So, there's a notion that vibrato is part rub and part rotation. And basically what you're doing is you're using the rotation, however you want to think of it, whether it's your wrist or your forearm, that rotation is creating rub through any part of the pad of the finger. So if you want to change how much we're hearing the vibrato, you can actually change how much pad you're rotating through. So for instance, when you get to that high C, rather than trying to really try and vibrate through the wrist, I wonder, could you turn your hand back and allow the rub to happen from like the inside of one nail to the outside of that same nail? Yeah, can you point even more back so that your fingernail's pointing somewhere off to the side? Bring your elbow back. There you go. We call this a pointed position. Would you play that? Yeah, good. Sometimes we want to get away from this. It's also a little bit easier to control the speed, I think, sometimes. Good. Where's your finger bent? Where's your finger bent? Oh, yeah, good. Yeah. So there are ways that we can actually use more of the flesh to try and get more of the width and the roundness of the vibrato that we're looking for. Pull up this chord again here. I went all fancy with my music. Let's see, when you see dolce in Brahms, or dolce in anything, how do you translate that into your playing?
Maybe more vibrato? And not as loud, or like not as many, like no notes would be accented.
Ah, yeah, good. So less peaks and valleys than espressivo, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I always challenge my students, like, do you think of a person that you know who the only way you would describe them is, they're sweet. They're just sweet. It's like, what's the depth of character of that person? And then think of someone that you know that you describe as being super expressive. And you imagine like the hand gestures and the crazy things that come out. So I'm wondering if you could keep everything a little more simple. It can be beautiful, but a little bit more simple. Good. Can you anticipate your second move? So the vibrato doesn't quite stop. Then at this point I'm keeping it fairly fairly narrow. Because we're going to start the crescendo that takes us up. Yeah, simpler. That was gross. I usually can blame it on the internet. Not anymore. Now it's all for real. In other words, don't overdo the triplet.
Okay.
Good, now keep going. And then on each note, try and think about making the width just a little bit more and more dramatic. Take your hand back, rather than so, that's hard to. Good. So as soon as we like have the thumb off or from behind the cello, we're into a world in which the fingers just know where they need to drop, right? They always know what interval they're hanging over. This is no different. It knows. The hand knows that. It knows where the A is. So we don't really have to, like show first finger like, hey, there's A, there's still. Just trust it.
Okay.
Yeah. Try it again. Typically need the thumb up, it makes it really confusing in terms of where to stop. And that would be a different kind of shift. You're gonna see that I already prepped my hand. But for me, my hand really kind of wants to keep going. Try to begin with just kind of letting your thumb float to the side. Yeah, and then as soon as you arrive, then you can like electrify your chicken. Yeah, good. Does that feel weird?
No, it feels fine.
Good, excellent. That's what I like to hear. Feels good. All right. Make us wonder what on earth is happening in that little spot there. Do you see where that is?
Yes.
Okay. left hand take more of the responsibility right now? So when I had giant issues over here, and my thumb position was, it was just awful. I worked a lot on getting my phrasing to sound right with a bow, and realizing the left hand would catch up at some point. I would recommend the reverse, like, can you get your left hand to really do something that for right now, even though you're pulling an amazing amount of sound out of your cello for having like this big giant cast. Cool. On a scale of 1 to 10, is that really what you wanted to say? What do you want to be different?
Like more steady, like dynamics.
Okay, so left hand will help that a lot. In other words, we start late. We're gonna have a blossom of sound in the left hand. Yeah, you're probably hearing the blossom now, right? Sounding different.
Yeah.
Good. Is there any way I can convince you to keep your elbow relaxed? I think that what happens is when we engage the bicep, it makes things a little tougher to actually kind of keep it even. That's great. Now go twice as fast as a broad speed. Good, which is why I hardly ever talk about speed on vibrato. Now just go twice as narrow. So instead of going, speed, something weird happens in my bicep without fail. If I just think about like controlling the width, whether I want it really, really wide or I want it really narrow, and of course it still affects the speed, but if I think about speed by itself, I just get tight. So if you just maybe and then tell us a really good story on that little rhythm in there. So start the same place and go on, please. Do you have any questions?
No.
When do you get all this? Do you know yet? Is it too soon?
On what?
On your bow hand.
Oh, I get it up in 4 weeks.
In 4 weeks, okay. Cool. So you have a lot of time to just work on some left hand stuff, which is really kind of cool. And, you know, just avoid doing any other injury, of course. But when you're start experimenting with the fact that it's like, this doesn't sound like rich vibrato, does it? But if I stop it, we realize that a little bit of vibrato becomes very special. The wider we go with it, the more extreme it gets. But I would do a little bit of your scales where you're just thinking about every note being the same width. Whatever scale is your favorite. Can you go even narrower? Yeah, good. then I would do the same notes and go for your widest. Where it sounds like a really old singer. You're gonna find that it's so annoying to try and actually maintain that, but would you try your widest? Oh, your second finger is nice. Your second finger is really nice. This is really rah, rah, rah. So I think your first finger, sometimes you lose some of the width because you stack your second finger on top. Yeah, there you go. Good. Awesome. Well, and as you re-enter, of course, take your time. Go back to some of your really basic bow exercises once your cast is off, to just kind of remind your pinky and the side muscles what they were there for in the first place. Yeah, thank you so much for playing, and good luck with that.